morning. First, we're going to look at God's Word after we've sung together now. And then, following that, we have baby dedication this morning. And baby dedications are always a special time in my mind, because as the parents come, it's actually a dedication, more of a parent's dedication than it is a dedication of the child. And so, it's a great time together this morning as we look at these different things. We are in the four-part attitude this morning. We're looking at, three other ones already, and the fourth one is maybe one of the more difficult ones that we're going to look at of the seven. The fourth one deals with relationships. And relationships can be very hard things to manage, can't they? It seems regardless if you were talking about the world or the church, relationships a relationship that has hit a rough spot or a difficult time are never easy things to repair or make right. Relationships are difficult. In our text this morning, Jesus addresses this part of relationships, the difficult times. And up on the screen this morning, you see where our text comes from, Matthew chapter 5, verse 23 and 24. And we read there, "So if you are offering your gift on the altar, and there you remember that your brother has something against you." Now, remember, in this case, we're not just talking about brothers. We're talking about brothers, sisters, you know, friends, family, mothers, fathers, husbands, wives. So we're not going to focus on just one little thing here. So not just brothers. So but here in the passage says, if a brother has something against you, leave the gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled with your brother. And then come and offer your gift. Often, as Christians, we make our faith very confusing. And even difficult at times, don't we? We tend to overthink things. And when in reality, Jesus has made it very simple for us. Never has anything that he asks us to do is really that complicated. When he asks us to come in faith, he says, simply come as you are, recognizing that we're sinners, and receive salvation. Very simple. It's not a hard thing to do, really. And when it comes to relationships, when it comes to these things, we tend to overthink things. In reality, again, Christ has made it very simple. And when it comes to relationships, he wants us to do what is the right thing to do. If we're unable to treat others as he's commanded, it does affect our walk with him. Because as you see here in this passage, tells us that in this passage that if you're coming to offer offer a gift, in other words, if you're coming to worship him, if you're coming to come into the temple, into the sanctuary, into the church, to offer a gift to him, which is can be not just we think our gift or our offering or sacrifice is what we bring when we pass the bag around in our church. At least my first thing that comes to mind is the plate. But in our culture, in the Chinese church, we pass a bag. And that's not the only thing that we offer. Our offering is, even though today was a very sleepy song service, it's our songs as well. Not only is it our money, not only is it our songs, it is the Word of God. We offer the Word of God to us. We bring and present the message to you. That's a gift, our gift from God, and it's our gift. It's a gift that we hear and listen to. And also, it's our prayer. These are all offerings. These are all gifts. These are all part of worship. And it says here in the passage of Scripture that we need to get things right before we do that. Not only with God, but with men. You should ask yourself, why do I feel distant from God? Have you ever asked yourself that? Why is it when I come into worship, I just don't feel great? Why is it when I come into worship, I just don't feel into it, so to speak? Well, there are various reasons. But as this is something that I have asked myself at different times, and I search for an answer in God's Word and God's people, from those who I look up to, and often I'm left with the answer that can be very difficult, very confusing. But here in these two verses that I just read, we find that Jesus gives us a very easy answer to the question of why I'm not really into worship, or why worship is so difficult, or why it just seems that things aren't right as I come into this place. And I would suggest that in many cases, this is the reality. Since most of the time, as we come into worship, there's many things in our lives we haven't truly dealt with. And we talk about sin. And if you look at sin, what is sin? Well, we talk about sin being something that we do against God, but often sin is never something that is just us. Usually sin in our lives includes those around us, doesn't it? It affects those around us. So, this is the problem here in this passage. And we really don't like the answer. Why do we have a hard time worshiping? Because we haven't dealt properly with each other. Our fourth hard attitude is clear up relationships. When we have difficulty in our walk with God, many of us do not want to look at this area of our life. We'd rather consider other possibilities or sins in our lives. We don't want to face others or be confrontational in any form or fashion. Even we know when we have a problem with another person, or that person has a problem with us, what we should really want to do is go to them and talk to them a little bit. Most of the time, though, we'd rather go on like everything is just fine. How we do things in church. We go to church and you know, I'll give you the best example ever. And most pastors' families face this. If you ask Pastor Ring's family, if you ask Pastor Nee's family, ask Pastor Felix's family and Pastor Milne's family, you'll find the same answer. On Sunday morning, one of the most difficult times in the morning is getting everybody ready to get to church on time. And that's when Satan gets going in your family's life. And I don't imagine it's much different than any other family, but you go and you get even this morning, it's like, Madeline, get ready to go. We need to get going. We're gonna be late. Come on, Madeline. And you're just like, matter, blah, blah, blah. And often the time that we get the biggest disagreements, I won't say arguments, maybe, but I guess that's probably what it is on the way to church on Sunday morning. But you know, the amazing thing is, we walk through the doors, we close the door to our car, and get out of the car and walk into the church. By the time we get into church, we have the biggest smiles on our face, and everything's just perfect. But it's not true. Now this morning, I would say that even though we had to rush Madeline, nobody was really angry, and nobody was really upset or anything like that. But you know, I really truly believe that we need to, and even in our families, we need to get our relationships right. We need to make sure things are right. And so when you come into this place and you find difficulties in worship, and you find difficulties in presenting yourself before worship, that is the problem. The problem with this, though, is we actually create a wall between each other, and even more disturbing, we create a barrier in our ability to worship God. Here in our passage, we see that before we can even think of even considering worship, we need to get our relationships in the body sorted out. Is it possible to come before God when we have issues with each other? To have a clear understanding of this, I think you need to actually go up a few verses. And if they go on in there into the passage of Scripture here, and I'll show you on the screen, verse 21 and 22. You look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 and 22, we understand better why we really do need to clear up our relationship before we come before God. In those in there, it says, you've heard that it is said to our ancestors, do not murder. And whoever murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you, everyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, fool, will be subject to the Sanhedrin, so the courts, the law. And whoever says, you moron, will be subject to hellfire. Now, this is a pretty good modern translation. Have you ever called anyone that you're driving along and they cut you off? You moron? You jerk? You idiot? Have you ever used those words? No, none of you have. Of course not. get ourselves right with God. We need to be able to come to worship. Have you ever thought of a brother or sister in this way? A brother and sister in Christ this way? Have you ever thought about any of your family this way? Yesterday, I'll give you another example. We're having a family issue. Not just my family, a big family issue. And my older sister is still treating me like I'm 12, I feel like sometimes. Even though we're in our 40s and they're in their 50s, you know? I never understand. But I was so irritated with them. I said to Ardell, I just don't understand why they treat me like this. I just don't get it. And I have to be honest, I probably thought some of these kind of things about them. And it truly does get in the way of our ability to worship. I'll tell you what, this morning, I was up at 4:30 in the morning thinking about this family issue. So since 4:30 this morning, I've been up thinking about how we're going to deal with this. And I think I have a plan. We have a way out or a way to figure this out and get through this. But it's very difficult. You know, we talk about each other. We think about each other this way. And when we put these two verses with the two verses in our text today, it's easy to see how important it is to correct and repair our relationships that have gone wrong. To clear up relationships. For when you think about someone in an angry way, or when you call them a moron, or when you call them a jerk, or whatever word you want to choose, or when you're angry at them, it's basically what I've got from this passage of Scripture in the Sermon on the Mount. It's no different than murder. Because you've murdered them in your mind. Clear up relationships. Now, most of us can find it easy to see when we are wrong, right? You know, it's pretty obvious when someone's been mean to you or said something nasty to you or talked poorly of us or went behind our backs and sort of stabbed us in the back or whatever the scenario is that you might think of. It's easy for us to do that. But in the text, we can see it's a little different, though. We are also to go to those who have agreements against us. So in other words, something when we've done something wrong to them. That takes something really special. That takes admitting that we're wrong. And as we all know, none of us would ever be wrong, now could we? Any of us in this room ever wrong? Had any of you ever done something that you probably shouldn't have done? Or maybe gossiped about someone that you shouldn't have gossiped about them? Or maybe you said something and you shouldn't have said it? Or you said it in such a way that you know someone might take it wrong? Or you said something to your spouse or your friend? You know, husbands and wives, we get to know each other pretty well. I've been married now forever, it seems like, but it's 27 years, right, or no? You know, it's more than half my life in America. And it's been a wonderful 27 years. Sometimes it's difficult, I'll be honest. There's times that we have hard times, and there's things that we say wrong to each other, and it's hard to admit that we're wrong. It's hard to go to the other one and say, for me to go to say, Ardell, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said it that way. Usually I poke for a little longer, and it takes a little longer for me to get to that point to do that. But you know, I'm really good at words. I've learned really well. My dad was never really, you know, a big person for spanking us or anything like that. He just had to use his words. You know, he would say things like, well, you don't have to go to church if you don't want to. Of course you're going to go. Right? But I know, so I've learned pretty well. I'm a good teacher. And I know when to take the knife and not just stick our elbow inside. I know how to twist it, don't I, dear? I'm pretty good at it, actually. But I never do anything wrong. It's always her fault. She made me do it. It's not my fault that she irritated me and I have to get back at her. And it's not my fault that, you know, we can go on and on, can't we? And if we do something wrong, we didn't mean to. So they just need to get over it, don't they? You know, Ardell just needs to get over it. Or my kids just need to get over it. Or my church family just needs to get over it. Or our brother and sister in Christ, you know, they just need to get over themselves and just move on. Is that what the scripture tells us? No. It says go to them.
Loving regardless of what
might act like or how they might talk about us. We need those kinds of things. And offering forgiveness, coming and being a person of peace and grace to one another, even when they might not be ready for it, just as Christ has been with us. John chapter 1, or 1 John chapter 4, rather, verse 20 and 21, then the message it reads this. I like how it's translated there. It says, if anyone boasts, I love God, and goes right on hating his brother or sister, thinking nothing of it, he's a liar. If he won't love the person he can see, how can he love the God he can't see? The command we have from Christ is blunt. Loving God includes loving people. You got to love both. So again, the steps are to make our lives right with one another is go to the person, not wait for them. Be willing to admit that you're wrong and be a person of peace and grace. I know it's not an easy thing to do, but it is what God demands of us. Sometimes the simplest things are the hardest things to do, but the hardest things do usually end up being the best things. You know, the hardest things that I've ever done for me is school. Any of you have a hard time with school? I have a difficult time with school. School's never easy for me. Standing before people and speaking is never easy for me. Yesterday, I preached at the annual meeting of the Midwest Baptist Association. I'd rather preach in front of thousands of people than preach in front of a bunch of preachers. It's the hardest thing to do in the world. But at the end, it was really a rewarding thing to do as well. As my peers came and said to me, they appreciated what I had to say. Going to a person sometimes is not the easiest thing to do, but it's worthwhile. I recall when I was in college, I was taking a Greek class, and I had one of the hardest, oldest professors at OBU teaching me, and he was a very intelligent man. He had a lot of information. But one day, all of us were sick. Ardell was sick. I was sick. Alexander and Lena were sick. And we were all home. And I missed a quiz. It wasn't even an exam. I went the next day, and he went up one side of me and down the other, and in front of everybody. And I was so angry. I said something to him. I can't even remember what I said to him. And I realized, even though I felt I was still right, I was wrong for disrespecting him in front of his class. He was a professor. I was a student. That afternoon, I went as very sheepishly, knocked on his door, and he opened the door, and I said to the professor, I said, sir, I'm very sorry. I know I was wrong. I should not have responded that way in front of class. Now, I'm not saying that I'm good at this. And the good thing was, if I didn't talk to him, I don't know what happened to my grade. But I think it was a worthwhile thing to do. I really do believe that in lots of ways, he was wrong. Because the one thing he said to me is, when you're sick and you enter the ministry, are you going to phone in sick and not go into church on Sunday morning? I said, I hope one day that I might be that way. But that thought has always stuck with me. And I recall one Sunday morning when I was at Saskatoon, and the Faith Baptist Church, I was sitting on the podium, and that time we all sit up on the podium waiting for through the song service, and I can't even remember who was leading. I think Lane Coster was leading the song service, and you don't know who he is, but the last song before I was to preach, I think as I was sitting there, I was getting greener and greener, and I ran out to the back. At the back of the sanctuary was the washroom, and I emptied the contents of my stomach. I walked back into the auditorium. One of the men who happens to be a man I really admire, Jack Connor, came to me and said to me, do you need me to preach? I said, no, I can do it. Now, to this day, I have no idea what I said. I hope something came out worthwhile. But that challenge to me to be a man of honor, be a man of grace, and do what God's called you to do, I made sure it stuck. Now, what I'm telling you, though, is that sometimes it's not easy, but it's worth it. And you know, going to someone and admitting you're wrong, or going to someone and working out an issue, is maybe some of the hardest things that we do. But But God demands it of us. If we want to come into this place and be able to worship with the freedom and grace He gives us, that's what we need to do. Romans 12, verse 16 says, "Be in agreement with one another. Do not be proud. Instead, associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own estimation." And we go down to Romans chapter 15, verse 5 through 7, it says, "Now may the God who gives endurance and encouragement allow you to live in harmony with one another, according to the command of Christ Jesus, so that you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ with a united mind and voice. Therefore, accept one another, just as the Messiah also accepted you." Clear relationships. Allow God to display to you what, show you what you need to do in your life. Clear up relationships so you have an opportunity to worship like you desire to worship. Clear up relationships so that you can have a walk with God that He desires to have. Because the reality is, when we don't clear up relationships, I believe that's where our biggest sin as believers in Jesus Christ enters in. So clear up relationships.